I invite Dr. Dinesh Talwar and Dr. Shroff to please come forward. So, sir, should you start or should I give the introductive talk? No, you have, right now a session you have to go to, no? So you talk first, sir. So Dr. Dinesh Talwar will be talking to us on AMD, how to manage on a long-term basis. Can we have Dr. Dinesh Talwar's talk, please? So we have a bucket of all the medical retinal disorders, common medical retinal disorders, including age-related macular degeneration, diabetic macular edema, and RVO, and how to inject, when to inject, how to move on, etc. Over to Dr. Dinesh Talwar. He is one person who has scientifically analyzed all the evidence in literature and has moved from the research side to the ward side. Sir, here please.
Thank you, Gopal. Age-related macular degeneration is now, with time, achieving epidemic proportions. The objective is not to maintain vision for 3 months, 4 months. The objective is what is the best bet. As far as the therapeutic armamentarium is concerned, we have mainly anti-VEGF agents, and those include ranibizumab, which is available as Lucentis, it's available as Razumab. Then we have aflibercept, which is also available as IV formulation called Zaltrap. And then we have obviously got bevacizumab and its biosimilars. What should the optimal treatment for a patient be? It should be effective, it should be safe, it should be easy to follow for a patient and the doctor, and the, as far as possible, the intervals should be more, should as be as long as possible, and it should be cost effective in terms of individual injection as well as the yearly cost. Balancing efficacy and safety considerations are the next important thing. Safety is important. Somebody may say efficacy is more important. But is that so? The most effective treatment for ARMD is argon laser. And what would happen at the end of that? No vision. So that's not what we are looking at. We are looking at something that is safe as well as effective. The problem with anti-VEGF agents is that they have effects on retinal and choroidal tissues, which are different with different agents. We already know from the CAT trial that Lucentis has more effect on chorioretinal atrophy as compared to bevacizumab. But it also seems that aflibercept has probably got even more effect as compared to Lucentis or ranibizumab. So this is a subject that needs more study. As far as systemic safety is concerned, there's only one drug which has been proven to be safe, and that was through the SAILOR trial, and that is not any dose, but only 0.3 milligrams of Lucentis. For those who say, well, my patients are poor, the fact is you have a standard of care, which is Lucentis and Eylea, but you have, for those who cannot afford them, the biosimilars in terms of Razumab, Zaltrap, and Avastin and his biosimilar. So it's not that you can say patients can't afford it. From the CAT trial, what we do know is that PRN ranibizumab is closer, if you see here, is closer to monthly Lucentis. PRN Avastin is not as good, so it's not as if they are equivalent. And if you see the amount of thickness, reduction in thickening, the maximum reduction occurs with monthly ranibizumab. So again, they're not similar. So which drug is optimal? Well, actually the gold standard is still monthly Lucentis. Monthly Avastin is almost as good, but the macula dries less quickly and less often. And I believe PRN Lucentis is better than PRN Avastin because the proportion of patients with vision loss of more than 3 years at three lines at 2 years was more in the group which received Avastin. Now, in case you have occult CNV, the first year use of aflibercept could decrease the number of injections, but second year onwards is the same. So which to use? That is finally an economic decision. And the best treatment depends on history of previous treatments, present findings, and the response to previous treatment. So let's see. If you have a finding like this of a serious detachment with minimal visual symptoms, that means it's non-progressive, it does not merit any treatment. It only merits observation. But in all other cases of predominantly classic CNV, progressive, mind you, progressive occult and progressive minimally classic CNV, three loading doses at monthly intervals are the starting point. And of course, in that I've already mentioned what the gold standard is. Now, monthly treatment is extremely intensive, exhausting for the patient and the doctor. But remember, for a patient who's one-eyed and 6'6", he will carry it out if you inform him properly. So do not say that the patients cannot carry it out. Now what happens after you've given the first three injections? Assess the treatment response at month three. If the lesion is dry, it's become okay, vision has stable or improved. Now follow up this patient with PRN treatment. If there are no recurrences for the next 3 months, continue a monitor and extend approach. And you increase the follow-up intervals progressively to 6, 8, 10, and maximum of 12 months. 6, 10, 8, 10 weeks, and then fine. If recurrence occurs during this period, give an injection and then follow up monthly till you get a dry lesion again. So this is just to show you a patient managed in such a manner. On the other hand, there are patients who do not become dry. The lesion doesn't become dry, but it stabilizes. Now, before you say it's stable, first try. Maybe over the next 6 months it will dry. Then if it dries, it continues as I've told you in the previous chart. But supposing it does not dry and just becomes stable, now this is where you can try treat and extend regime till quarterly injections are reached. So you give the injection at 4 weeks, then 6 weeks, then 8 weeks, then 10 weeks. And if the lesion, if it doesn't deteriorate, you can continue on this. Before you start this, it's worth, if the patient can afford it, giving a trial of aflibercept, because it's possible it may work when the Lucentis is not working. Now what should you do when there's no fluidonosity? Should we stop? Now you see over here, treated, dry. Now at least two consecutive OCTs with no fluid before you stop treatment in patients who respond after multiple injections for the first time. And what about the patients who do not respond? Patients are, vision is decreasing, lesion is active. The monthly injections will continue or till a stable stage is reached. And if after 6 months, if after 3 months you're getting a decrease, then aflibercept is definitely warranted. So this is what, you have a patient who is not responding. Now what are the alternatives? If it's an occult CNV, the option is aflibercept. If it is a classic CNV, the option is PDT with anti-VEGF. That's combination therapy. Are there patients who don't need any treatment? Well, as I mentioned, non-progressive occult CNVs with vision better than or equal to 6/12, as I showed you, or even here. Patients with a disciform scar, and there's no fluid, there's no point treating. Vision has dropped to a level he's not going to benefit. Foveal atrophy, these are patients who don't need any treatment. But there are situations where aflibercept may be the best treatment. These are the non-responders, vision is better than 660, OCT is positive, not responding to Lucentis, give a trial of aflibercept. Patient is better than 660, vision deteriorates, consider aflibercept, especially for the occult lesions, or combination therapy for the predominantly classic lesions. And if there are large RPE detachments at presentation and a patient can afford it, it may be worth trying aflibercept if the patient is willing. This is just to show you how we use aflibercept as a rescue. This was a patient not responding to aflibercept, 12 injections given to Lucentis. One injection of aflibercept, the lesion dried up. Now maintain after that on Lucentis, and you can see we could maintain for many months. So with 2-3 injections, we could maintain off aflibercept, and then giving Lucentis, we could maintain this patient. This patient on Lucentis deteriorated to 6/18, got one injection, improved to 6/9, and then again maintained with Lucentis. So ladies and gentlemen, you have your workhorse, and then you have the rescue therapy in the form of aflibercept, and which injection that you need to give at a particular time to maintain your vision is not a random process. It needs a careful understanding of cost and risk-benefit ratios. And you need to do different regimes at different times. Also, you need to keep other diseases in mind. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Dinesh Talwar, for opening up that AMD. So now we will move into another disease, basically diabetic retinopathy. And here I am just setting the stage by a very theoretical talk of the pathogenesis of vascular diseases in general. We know that normal retina, it's partitioned from the systemic circulation by the blood retinal and blood aqueous barriers, and it receives nutrition from the retinal and choroidal circulation. So there is bound to be some interactions, even though it is not complete. We all know about diabetic retinopathy. The immediate clinical pathogenesis, endothelial cell damage causes breakdown in the inner retinal barrier, resulting in a lot of accumulation of hard exudates and etc. Loss of pericytes, which actually causes the microaneurysms to form and then they will leak. And then ischemia, which is a major player, which causes neovascularization. But what happens behind the stage? So this is a diagram which shows that in diabetes, we have different growth factors, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, hormones, hyperglycemia. All these will move into different pathways like PKC, polyol pathway, advanced glycation product. All these will cause oxidative stress. There will be oxygen free radicals which liberated, which will cause apoptosis, inflammation, and that will cause ischemia and neovascular damage. So this is a typical diabetic macular edema. The retinal pigment epithelium is normal. You can see a lot of swelling fluid here with hard exudates. The vessels have become abnormal because of pericyte loss. There is a microaneurysm which is formed, and this is a typical change here. And almost all these changes occur below the RPE or at the level of the outer retina in age-related macular degeneration. So the first thing to form would be advanced glycation end products, which is pentosidine and CML. CML is carboxymethylysine. So these are the common advanced glycation products, which are the first in the pathogenesis and accumulates in vascular cells, neurons, and glia. And that is the start of the process. Way back in 2001 itself, we have found that VEGF, CML as well as non-CML advanced glycation end products increase in diabetic retinopathy. And there is another thing called galactin, which actually in the pre-ischemic stage itself, it increases. Then there are lots of metabolites before you form the growth factors, which we commonly talk about. These metabolites, all these metabolites act through the nitrous oxide synthase inhibitor pathway, which actually increases the reactive oxygen species, the ROS, which is the basic pathogenesis of diabetic retinopathy as well as a lot of other diseases. Now coming to the inflammatory side and angiogenic markers, which we all know, VEGF is the most major marker, which over the last 10 years have been continuing to happen. So there are lots of other markers like IL-6, IL-10, IL-1 beta, IL-8, MCP, all these markers actually cause problems in it. We did a small study, looked at VEGF levels in the aqueous after each injection of ranibizumab to differentiate responders from non-responders. Basically, we need to find out who are responders and who are non-responders, and whether VEGF levels are correlating with vision improvement and CMT improvement over a 6-month period. So more than 300 microns, logmar vision and OCT were taken. Each time injection was given, an aqueous VEGF was measured, and 40 patients were involved in this. So we divided the patients based on vision, good vision to poor vision, based on CMT and baseline VEGF. Now let's look at each of these things. This is poor vision. When logmar increases, vision reduces. Poor vision patients also improved in vision by the end of 6 months by 3 lines. Whereas that much improvement was not there with good vision patients. Maybe a 1 line improvement or a 0.5 line improvement. But these poor vision patients definitely had larger CMT, near about 600, and the CMT declined even more than the other groups. So that means that in the poor vision patients, there is a lot of atrophy. What is happening to the VEGF levels at that point of time? The poor vision patients had the higher VEGF levels, but you can see that it almost equalized all the other groups, but then this increased significantly whenever you withheld the injection, the VEGF levels significantly increased. Based on baseline central macular thickness, you can again see if the CMT was high, VEGF was high, and vision was poor. And you can see again that in these patients in which VEGF was high because of high CMT, the moment you stopped injection, there was a surge of VEGF. Again, based on baseline VEGF levels, so these are the baseline VEGF levels, and in higher VEGF patients, you can see that the CMT was high and the vision was poorer, but you can see that the best response was not in the lowest VEGF level, but it is between 500 and 1000. So there are two groups, one on the extreme right end where the VEGF levels are very high, and the other on the extreme other side where the VEGF levels are quite low. These two groups are not responding quite well. In the group in which the VEGF levels are low, it may be other cytokines which may be playing a role. And in groups where VEGF level is very high, obviously because of the VEGF levels, we are having a problem. With this introduction, I will invite Dr. Shroff to continue on the management of diabetic macular edema and see how clinically we are able to improve the visual acuity. Thank you.
So I'll be speaking on managing diabetic macular edema, top 10 tips. So I think Dr. Gopal Pillai has really made my task easy because the nuts and bolts and all about VEGF and how the pathophysiology and anatomy of this disease has already been dealt with. So I'll just give 10 practical tips which I think are important according to me. Why is this important? Because we know that macular edema can occur at any stage of DR, and it's one of the major causes of vision loss in any case of diabetic retinopathy. So here goes. Tip number one, look beyond the eye. We must always know that good metabolic control can retard the progression of diabetic retinopathy and even reverse some of the changes, especially macular edema and hard exudates. So look beyond the eye. Don't concentrate only on the eye. Look at the patient holistically. These are the levels which are important, and also ask a history of other medicines like pioglitazone usage, which can also be causing the edema. So this is a very nice slide from the DCCT, which shows a dramatic change in the amount of retinopathy based on the HbA1c ratio. And this also gives us a motivation to tell our patient to control the HbA1c. A group from Chandigarh, Professor Amod Gupta's group, has shown and published in AGO how lowering the lipids and using statins has helped in reducing the severity of the heart exudates and the subfoveal lipid migration. Number two, a good clinical exam. This is not a dinosaur which has gone extinct. A good clinical exam is extremely important in every patient with diabetic retinopathy. Tip three, FFA still has a role. So why do we still need angiography in diabetic macular edema? You need to image the vasculature. It guides the treatment of macular edema, especially in some cases where, of course, we all are going to talk about anti-VEGF, but focal laser still has a role. And subtle neovascularization, which may be missed on clinical exam, is also caught, and I'll just show you one picture which clinically does, which you see the photo doesn't look so bad, but look at the amount of ischemia, and the patient is not going to get very good vision. So here it's a very good thing to have an angiography. Wide field imaging has helped us, and we're going beyond the macula at factors which can influence the macula and require treatment. Number four, OCT is indispensable. We can't get away from it. It gives us beautiful in vivo histology like anatomical details. And it's very useful for quantification and treatment of edema and tracking the response, like to any anti-VEGF therapy we give, to steroid therapy, we have to use the OCT to track that. Tip number five, don't junk your laser. Non-center involving macular edema, metabolic control first, second should be focal laser. If there's gross thickening, we can have a combination therapy, first anti-VEGF to reduce the edema and then follow it up with a focal laser. This is some typical cases you can see in which the focal laser would do very well. And here's a small animation showing you how it's done. And this is the response to the laser beautifully seen on the OCT. So despite protocol S from the DRCR net, which found that ranibizumab for PDR is non-inferior to PRP, suggesting that this may be the preferred treatment and we can grow with laser, we would still recommend that we still think of laser as a first line in certain patients. And also you must remember, even the conclusion of protocols S says long-term follow-up is required. Tip number six, and this is the topic of today, all anti-VEGFs are awesome. So I'm not just saying it emotionally that they're awesome. Protocol T compared Avastin, Lucentis, and Eylea. And it found that the gains were, of course, greater for aflibercept than for Avastin, but only for patients with less than 20 by 50 vision. And 1 year, aflibercept was better than ranibizumab, but at 2 years, this difference was not identified. So all are really good, and we can use almost any of them for this. Tip number seven, if anti-VEGFs don't work, try Ozurdex. So we have a scientific basis. We have a randomized controlled study of patients who were with persistent macular edema, which did not respond to the anti-VEGF therapy, doing well with Ozurdex. So this is always in our armamentarium for such patients. Tip eight, so nowadays, of course, we get eyes which are vitrectomized and they have edema. So how do we handle such patients? We are at a loss to do so. So I'll just, to make it interesting, I'll just show one of my own cases and how she did well. This is a 77-year-old lady, first seen in 2011, 6.9 parts vision. FFA looks fairly stable. We said we will observe. She came back after 2 years in 2013. Right eye has bled, so we can't get an OCT, but you can see the left eye OCT with a lot of macular edema. And this right eye, we said conservative management. We had done a B scan. Everything was okay. And the left eye, we gave anti-VEGF. And it didn't do better. So in February, that's after 2 months, the right eye had a vitrectomy. So now you can see both eyes with macular edema. And in this case, because there was a lot of cystoid macular edema, we advised Ozurdex. But patient was not convinced for Ozurdex. She said, I want to observe. Why did we advise Ozurdex in this case? Because there's a lot of evidence to show that there was not much change in thickness with anti-VEGF only. And dexamethasone intravitreal implant for the treatment for macular edema is excellent in vitrectomized eye. So finally, I think since it didn't go down, it didn't budge, we convinced her for Ozurdex. And you can see how nicely the edema has gone down with the steroid implant. So basically, this is just in a nutshell to save time. These are the serial OCTs and what therapy we did. And you can see that later she's quite happy. Both eyes seem to have settled down. And very interesting, the right eye, which is vitrectomized, needed only 3 Ozurdex injections to settle, whereas the left eye in this 2 year period required 6 such implants. So now we move to the next tip, tip number 9, don't rush into vitrectomy. So vitrectomy has a definite role in DME associated with VMT. Where there's traction, yes, we must do operation, but it's still very controversial that for non-tractional refractory edema, should we do vitrectomy or not? And the study quoted below from Retina Journals found that in diffuse DME with no traction, it produces a short-term improvement in the thickness. Yes, the thickness goes down, but no long-term anatomical or functional improvement. This is one of our patients who in fact did quite well, had an ERM, so we did a vitrectomy, ER removal, and also important, we also combined an anti-VEGF. So we can combine anti-VEGF or Ozurdex on table for such patients. Combination therapy works well and they do well. My last tip, it's not always a retina. So you know, as retina doctors, you may be always inundated with patients from anterior segment people. So this is the story of a very unhappy lady, 624, 618 vision, pseudophakic both eyes. She had good post-op vision, but she said, my vision is gone now, and an urgent retina referral was made. So this was the patient. She was advised better metabolic control and given anti-VEGF. We planned PRP once the edema went down. Nothing happened. She had a lot of edema. So we asked her for steroids, and you can see that edema is persisting. We gave her Ozurdex injection. Still unhappy. You can see her follow-up is very erratic. She's come after 6 months, so we don't even know whether Ozurdex has acted or not. And then after this, she comes after 9 months, and you can see you can hardly get any scan, so the OCT. So something we were missing all along. So the PCO has become so dense that you can hardly image the retina. So we just advised YAG capsulotomy, and you can see how beautifully, and also you can see the traction has gone over the retina in the right eye. So innocuous, so just a small tip that PCO can trouble patients a lot, and we should time the YAG when there's no edema or under the cover of injections. Don't always blame the retina. You can get a very happy patient with this. So I conclude this amalgamation of clinical trial data and common sense is the best bet for our patients. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Darius. It was an excellent talk. We will have Dr. Mahesh speak. These are back-to-back talks, and he will be speaking on steroids in medical retina primary therapy or maintenance. and then we will have a discussion. You make your questions ready. We will have a small discussion on AMD and diabetic macular edema.
Thank you, Gopal. This steroids in medical retina, I will just cover both DME and vein occlusions. So the DME, we have the treatment options like steroid, anti-VEGF, surgery, laser photocoagulation. And in steroids, we have Ozurdex. Iluvien is not available in India, and IVT is not approved in India. And anti-VEGF agents and all the other things we know, all of us know. The limitations are anti-VEGF needs monthly dosing trials, repeated injections, cannot use in vitrectomized patients, and in some stroke and MI recently, it is difficult to use. And a substantial group of patients are unresponsive or poor response to anti-VEGF. So these are, and poor patient compliance will be there. So these are the problems. IVT or steroid, IVT is not approved for ophthalmic use, unpredictable response, and Iluvien is not available. So we have Ozurdex, which I will come across in the next few slides. Is diabetic retinopathy an inflammatory disease? Inflammation may represent an inciting and final common pathway leading to complex pathology, that is diabetic retinopathy. So there is an element of inflammation in all diabetic retinopathy. So mediators of inflammations like VEGF, interleukin 6, 8, ICAM, MCP, all this has been found to be responsible for diabetic macular edema, resulting in retinal vascular permeability changes and severity of DME. So what is macular edema? It is due to chronic hyperglycemia. There is loss of retinal capillary endothelial cell tight junctions, leading to inflammatory mediator release, which also upregulate VEGF, resulting in vascular permeability and macular edema. So there is definitely a role of inflammation, anti-inflammatory drugs in DME. So why corticosteroid steroids are used? They are effective because they target VEGF and inflammation and inhibit the release of pro-inflammatory mediators. And I'll just go through a few studies, just take-home messages, like FAME study. They found that compared Iluvien, and they found that it is a significant improvement in visual acuity in the treatment groups compared with sham. Steroids are effective in DME. Ozurdex has been studied well by different studies like Mead study, Mozart, Chamblin, and Placid study. Mead study found dexamethasone implant, and they found that dex implant 0.7 and 0.35 milligram improved the visual acuity over the 2 years, 3 years in fact, in diabetic macular edema. Placid study is a primary laser with adjunctive implantable dexamethasone in DME. They also found that, they compared dex with laser and only laser. So they found dex with laser is always improving visual acuity. So this is another study in support of steroids in DME. And the Chamblin study found that in vitrectomized eye, we don't have much of a choice because the drug clearance will be much faster with anti-VEGF. So Ozurdex may be the only option in vitrectomized eyes. So these are some of the key points. Dex implant is safely reducing DME, and all the summary of findings in all these studies. So Mozart study is another study which also showed that diabetic macular edema responds well to intravitreal dexamethasone implant. So dexamethasone has an anatomical and functional effectiveness in the treatment of DME, and outcome of treatment of patients and lower central retinal thickness suggests the duration of DMS and previous treatments are negative factors for the recovery. Just not to confuse, this is a beautiful flow chart where we which help us to decide when to use dexamethasone and when to use anti-VEGF. If there is, so center sparing DME, always laser is still the option. Center involving DME without any cardiovascular diseases, we can go for either anti-VEGF or Ozurdex. And second line, if it doesn't work, you can switch. Usually anti-VEGF followed by Ozurdex. If there is a cardiovascular disease or stroke, probably Ozurdex may be the first line. And in a vitrectomized eye, Ozurdex may be the first line. So this is just the summary of what I told in the different studies. And coming to the same points, recent cardiovascular events, vitrectomized, and the frequent injections are required in some DME. You can give dexamethasone implant, which will reduce the number of injections. So these are some of the cases which I showed. One of that finding that one of the use of dexamethasone implant is when there is a lot of lipids in the macula, this works much better than the anti-VEGF. I'm not talking about the hard exudate migration to the plaque, migration of plaque to the fovea. So this is another, a case of bad case of diabetic maculopathy with statins, laser, and IVTA. This has become like this. So over 3-4 years. These are old cases, like when we are using IVTA more than Ozurdex. This is another case, difficult case, bad macula with cataract. So cataract surgery, IVTA, laser, multiple steps over many years. This has become like this, significant improvement over 5-6 years. So triamcinolone really helps in this sort of cases. This is another case with diabetic macular edema. You can see the difference in pre-treatment and post-treatment eyes. This is another case. The upper pictures are pre-treatment, lower pictures are post-treatment. So when there is a lot of lipids, I think Jay Chablani is not here. He has done a lot of work in maculopathy with a lot of lipids in the. This is another case, pre-treatment and post-treatment. Just to this, the picture itself is very, will make us very happy. A case of laser, focal laser along with Ozurdex pre-treatment, and the lower right is the post-treatment treatment. He is doing very well over the last 4-5 years. This is a cataract with maculopathy. There is a lot of exudates, hazy view. Sometimes we do give intravitreal Ozurdex along with cataract surgery, and then followed by laser. Post-treatment on the right side, you can see beautiful macula. So this is another case of resolution of hard exudate over 6 months, status post a single Ozurdex and statins. All these cases, we give statins also. You can see over the 6 months, significantly reduced with marginal improvement of visual acuity also. Still, the plaque is there in the. So this is the OCT finding in this case. Now, coming to retinal vein occlusion, there are different treatment options. Here also, inflammation has a role in the pathology. And similar to diabetic macular edema, there is hypoxia, ischemia, inflammatory mediators, VEGF, vascular permeability, and macular edema. So treatment options are there, laser, intraocular steroids, and anti-VEGF. Different studies are there to help us guiding our treatment. SCORE study, BRVO, they found probably grid laser was a little better than IVTA. CRVO, they found some use of steroids in pseudophakic eyes. Then Geneva study, compared dex implants with sham injection, significantly open label study. They found significantly improvement in Ozurdex group. So definitely, based on all these studies, we have found that in BRVO, Ozurdex or anti-VEGF has definitely a role. The probably the decision making is done by the systemic parameters and glaucoma and all other factors. CRVO also similar. So many CRVO, the problem in CRVO different, which is different from our diabetic macular edema, is that CRVO, many of them have underlying glaucoma, like normal tension glaucoma. Many of them are steroid responders, especially young CRVOs. So this has to be very carefully monitored. So IVTA may not be a good steroid in these cases, but definitely the Ozurdex may be a much better option with less IOP rise and less injections. This is a case, left eye is bad from beginning, right eye CRVO. And over the years, first 2-3 injections were Lucentis, then she was not able to take monthly injections, then it was shifted to Ozurdex because we could reduce the number of injections as well as the macula is remaining dry for a longer time. So for a maintenance in these cases, Ozurdex may be a good option. And this is a follow-up pre-treatment at the last visit last month. She is maintaining 6x36, and you can see the Ozurdex lying in the fundus. Ozurdex, you can see the wide angle angiogram. So in conclusion, in RVO, steroids can be used as a maintenance treatment which requires less visits, which is cheaper, and which is much which requires much lesser number of injections. Thank you for the kind attention.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mahesh. We'll have a brief interaction about diabetic macular edema and AMD before we go into the further discussions. So in AMD, when will you give Eylea, Mahesh?
The in Indian setup, the most common problem is cost currently. And so Eylea will be my second line of drug in AMD as of now.
First so line. Never you will use Eylea as a first line?
Very unlikely.
Okay.
Very unlikely. Because so there was a small group like very good vision, subfoveal polyp, this sort of small group, one night, these sort of cases. PDT may be a little more difficult to predict the outcome. So okay. These cases may be the only case where I use ILE as the first line.
Okay. Anand. So Anand, what is your thought process about, you know, Lucentis as the first choice or Avastin as the first choice or ILE as the first choice in wet AMD?
Yeah, so the thing is, first and foremost, in our country, I mean, let's talk, I mean, practical real world situations. In our country, cost is the main driver. Okay, insurance is not the thing. But speaking from a point of science, if that was not the case, if cost was not the issue, insurance available, then for wet AMD with occult CNVMs, where there is a large PD there, and we're talking of only AMD, we're not talking of PCB, then maybe if cost is not an issue, I would go with ILEA, given other people's experience of the effect of flattening of PEDs with ILEA. And I think in that situation, yes, I would think of ILEA first.
So your stock treatment in the management of AMD would be Lucentis or Avastin? Which would you prefer?
Yeah, given safety and given efficacy, I would go with Lucentis. Again, you're saying cost is not an issue, I would go with Accentrix or Lucentis.
Okay. Now, Darius, so in your diabetic macular edema, how often do you consider anti-VEGF monotherapy? How early would you shift into something which is a long-lasting, when do you decide that you want to shift the drug or you want to shift it into a long-acting steroid implant? Yeah.
So basically, there are a lot of factors we have to see. Basically, and I think safety comes first. So initially, yeah, you're right. We would like to start off with anti-VEGF monotherapy. And there's no golden figure like that. But generally, we wait at least 3 injections. And after that, we think of shifting. And more so, like if the patient has other, like history of stroke or MI, then there's a chance that we would shift the patient even sooner to Ozurdex because that would be considered safer for the patient with the systemic issues.
Is there any audience, any pressing questions that we can ask now? One or two questions we can ask now? Okay, please can you come to the mic and ask, madam?
Earlier, I was practicing in Hong Kong. I've been there for 19 years, and then I've relocated to India now. There, what happened prior to every intravitreal injection of Lucentis or ILEA, the blood pressure was taken, and it was just noted down. But in India, since I've been practicing, there is no blood pressure record or anything. And I just want to know that whenever we give intravitreal injection, as Dr. rightly pointed out, that given the case of myocardial infarction or stroke, then we would shift to steroids. So what is the trend? Do we check blood pressure for every patient? Do we note down the history prior to every intravitreal injection that we give? What is?
Madam, your practice, you can define your clinical methodology. So in my practice, I check the blood pressure of all my patients before the patient gets an intravitreal injection.
We have a checklist.
We have a detailed discussion. We have a consent form which is signed. So your practice, you need to define what all you need to do before you give an injection. Safety comes first.
Yeah. I think most institutions and most of the time that we've heard presentations and all, almost everybody looks at, everybody's now safety conscious.
Yes.
So blood pressure is a very basic investigation. That's not just for injections. I think for any invasive procedure, you need to do this basics essentials there. And that needs to be recorded on that case sheet.
Yes.
It's not just good enough to just take it and say, okay, you're fine, you can go to the OT. But I think that's critical.
Yeah, and probably blood sugar also.
Yeah, and now with accreditation and NABH quality coming in, it's going to be more and more likely that this will all be recorded because it's essential for the process.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we will move ahead with the next talk. Injections in retinopathy of prematurity, primary therapy or adjunct to laser. Now there's going to be a shift in practice from doing laser in ROP primarily to doing injections in ROP. And that has all come after the famous paper which came out. And Anand, please, let's make it a little bit more knowledgeable about it.
So thank you for this opportunity to speak here. And basically, ROP is one of the leading causes of childhood blindness worldwide. It's now becoming a major public health concern in India. Over 50,000 children today are blind from ROP. That's a huge number. And in India, the incidence varies between 38% to 52% in low birth weight infants. And this is a potentially preventable, very tragic, needless cause of blindness. So what is the rationale for anti-VEGF therapy? First of all, lasers, the current gold standard from ETROP, unfortunately does not rule out poor outcomes in the more virulent forms of ROP. The shortcomings of laser, as we know, visual field loss, high refractive errors, especially in the zone 1 disease. It's difficult to do in hazy cornea lens, which is haze, with severe posterior ROP, AP-ROP, small pupils. It's slower to regress very severe pathology, and I dare say it requires more skill. And this is probably one area where you need some post-fellowship experience. The strengths of anti-VEGF, on the other hand, not tissue destructive, therefore less visual field defects, refractive errors, continued normal retinal vascularization is possible in severe posterior ROP, AP-ROP, small pupils, and hazy media. A more rapid response to an aggressive ROP, where you need a rapid response, and easier to administer. Now, this graphic from beta ROP kind of puts everything together. You know, you have the first, the phase 1, 22 to 30 weeks, phase 2, 31 to 44 weeks. Phase 1 has increased oxygen, decreased VEGF, and phase 2 is where there's a relative hypoxia with increase of VEGF, which takes the neovascularization forward. Now, you can see those different stages out there, and if it's not treated, at this point, you will get these tractional complications. And you can see with the ablative therapies, cryo and laser, you get the lack of vascularization beyond that point, whereas with Avastin or Bevacizumab, you get this going forwards. Now, when there is an imbalance of VEGF, as you can see in this cartoon, what happens is there's disorganized angiogenesis and there's vessel dilatation as well as elongation. Now, the timing of anti-VEGF is also important. If it's too early, it may interfere with necessary retinal vascularization. If it's too late, it may accelerate the cicatricial phase or cause a crunch and lead to early retinal detachment. So it's important to know when to strike. The common indications, AP-ROP is basically posterior location, prominence of plus disease, flat neovascular proliferation, vascular loops, and AV shunts, seen mainly in the zone 1 or zone 2, needs, mandates immediate and aggressive management. In the Western world, small infants, low birth weight, but as the PGI study showed us, it can happen even in higher birth weight, more mature babies in our country. Plus disease is also an indication. Now, the beta ROP trial, which basically ushered in a new dawn in the management of, you know, classic posterior ROP and AP ROP, basically a prospective controlled multicenter trial looked at intravitreal bevacizumab monotherapy of zone 1 and zone 2 posterior stage 3 plus ROP. Patients were randomized to 0.6 to 5 milligram bevacizumab or laser. And the primary ocular outcome was recurrence of ROP requiring retreatment at less than 54 weeks. Of the 150 infants, 143 made it to the 54-week timeline. 7 of them died, were not included in the analysis primarily. And the results, now ROP recurred in 4 infants, or 6 out of 140, or 4% of eyes, which was way lesser than with the erstwhile laser, where there was 22%, 19 infants, 30 out of 146 eyes, statistically significant. And a significant treatment effect for bevacizumab, therefore, was found for zone 1 ROP, but not for zone 2 ROP. And this classic iconic picture from the beta ROP shows very clearly that with the laser, you can see how this entire posterior area is ablated, and this patient is definitely going to have persistent visual field loss. Whereas a more aggressive form of ROP around the same time, 2-3 months, when injected, this beautiful revascularization you can see at the same time point, 13 months. So that in light the advantage of Avastin. So intravitreal bevacizumab, in conclusion, as compared with the conventional laser, in infants with stage 3 plus ROP, showed a significant benefit for zone 1, but not zone 2 disease. On the other hand, Huang's 5-year retrospective study showed very clearly, looking at 54 eyes with type 1 ROP, 22 eyes receiving Avastin, 32 eyes receiving PRP, showed results were that in the Avastin, regression was much faster in 48 hours, whereas lasers 1 to 2 weeks. In the meantime, from initial treatment to reach zone 3 was 5.5 months with Avastin. And the opposite was seen here, although it was a retrospective study, that 14% of the 22 treated eyes ROP record, which was much more than in the PRP treated eyes with 3%, which is why a lot of most of the experts here prefer to, if they can do PRP, they would still go first with PRP. So this is a case of post-laser eye and post-bevacizumab. As you can see, the vascularization happening. Now, what are the issues with anti-VEGF? We talked about the good parts, but there are safety issues. There is morbidity, neurodevelopmental issues are there, mortality, late recurrences can happen, structural abnormalities have been seen, and there is dose variability. Now, mortality issues. In the beta ROP study, 5 out of 7 bevacizumab and 2 out of 7 laser patients died. But Helen Minsner came out very strongly to say that mortality comes up in editorials. It seems that a lot of people can count a lot better than they can read. But I want to point out that three of the Avastin patients had non-Avastin-related deaths. Basically, if you remove those three, it's 2 out of 7 in both the groups, and it's pretty similar. On the other hand, the same following up about neurodevelopmental issues from the same group, Beta Ropi group, Kennedy et al., showed in their study with about, they followed up the patients. Of these 18 patients, there were no significant differences between bevacizumab and laser therapy in terms of weight, length, head circumference, cerebral palsy, or Bayley scores. And they showed no adverse effect from both the groups on medical or neurodevelopmental outcomes. Basically, gave it a safe, clean sheet. But a more recent one from Morin et al. On neurodevelopmental outcomes following this thing, looking at 125 patient infants, 27 Avastin, 98 laser. It was retrospective. And they looked at neurodevelopmental outcomes at 18 months. Results showed median motor scores were lower in infants who had received bevacizumab, and the odds of severe neurodisability in terms of cerebral palsy, hearing aids, blindness, was 3.1 times higher for patients treated with bevacizumab. So there's still a big cloud over Avastin. It's not as rosy as it is sometimes made to be by some. Recurrence issues. Now, the time to recurrence from the BEAT was significantly different. Bevacizumab 16 plus minus 4.5 or 6 weeks, much longer than laser, which is 6.2 plus minus 5.7. So recurrences, this was noted by Darius Moshfeghi in his editorial, would have occurred even after the primary endpoint of the study. And Muller and Salcho in their study suggested that recurrences after IVEV treatment may occur in about 12% of cases, 12 to 15 weeks after the first treatment during prolonged. So you have to wait long. You can have late surprises with Avastin. Structural abnormalities can happen in the periphery. You can see peripheral avascular areas, abnormal loops, tufts and hypovascular areas, and AV shunts. And can also be seen in the center. You see a bevacizumab-treated patient, there's no real FAZ here, whereas with a laser-treated patient, the FAZ is formed well. And you can also have some wild, strange abnormalities like this abnormal pigmentary dystrophy. Dosing issues, bevacizumab half-life is still not very well understood in premature infants, and the wide variability in axial length can lead to variable dosing. This table from Corner very beautifully shows that with increasing axial length, you see the concentrations keep decreasing in the vitreous. So it's a little obfuscated there. And different studies have used different doses, of course, with good results, but there is that variability in literature. The Cochrane review brought out by our friends in Ames is the last word. It showed reasonably good strength of evidence for anti-VEGF, bevacizumab, ranibizumab monotherapy in terms of reducing risk of refractive errors, significantly reduced risk of recurrence in zone 1 ROP, increased risk of recurrence in zone 2 ROP. They didn't find great strength of evidence, low quality strength for other issues like RD, mortality, corneal lens, no differences in perioperative retinal hemorrhages. So finally, take-home messages, gold standard management is still laser photocoagulation, has its own limitations as we understand, myopia, peripheral field constriction, macular dragging, hazy media. And if you, Jeff, maybe use this primary therapy in APROP, severe zone 1 posterior ROP. Adjuvant role, laser may be used as adjuvant in the above when residual peripheral avascularity persists, when you suspect non-compliance for follow-up, the child may not come back. Suboptimal response with anti-VEGF, that neovascular stays there, then you might put in, and with peripheral 360 degrees of avascular, you might put in some laser there. But remember that use of anti-VEGF should warrant long-term follow-up of babies and watchfulness for side effects. Additionally, vigilance, as I showed, for peculiar peripheral as well as central vascular abnormalities, avascularity is needed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anand. It is a very well-reviewed presentation. We are blessed by the presence of Dr. Subhadra Jalali here, who is the opinion maker and decision maker in as far as ROP is concerned. So Dr. Mahesh has a question to you, madam.
Madam, this Avastin generally has a lot of implications now, medical, legal and all. How safe is it in pediatric cases in the current scenario? How at risk we are when we inject? He is showing that it is the neurodevelopment problems are 3.1 times in Avastin injected babies. The problem is if you get a medical legal comment, it will be running into crores in babies, not lakhs.
Thank you for coming.
My pleasure. I came here to learn. So, see, my take is that if you're going to climb Mount Everest, you have to be ready, prepared. You can't climb and say, oh my God, I forgot my oxygen cylinder. These are high-risk cases. We are dealing with a high-risk situation. We need to be prepared. And the best preparation for doctors is to document everything, to have SOPs and protocols. So, no court or anything says that, you cannot get a side effect or a complication. The problem is if you have not handled that complication well. So for the same complication, let's say an end of, a doctor may get sued, his hospital may be burned down, but others may escape. So we have to find out what are the best practices. Why does somebody have a good relation with the patient? How you, you know, start your communication? How you do all the documentation? So the ophthalmologist who was sued in Delhi, he has done a good job. He has written ROP screening done. No ROP, come in 2 weeks. The court has not accepted this. They have said, did you dilate the baby? Where in the file it is written, what drop was put? We are not documenting. Do we document for any of our cataract surgery or any patient that we have put eye drop or we have put phenylephrine and how many times we have put? Then have you written what was the pupil dilatation? Have you written that it was indirect ophthalmoscopy or direct ophthalmoscopy or retinoscope? So the court will then say, so the court didn't accept. They sued that ophthalmologist. They said he didn't write anything. We don't know whether he even screened the baby. Maybe he did undilated screening. You know, so if you are prepared and you think that, you know, these are the questions courts keep on asking and we need to document everything. So for Avastin, we follow the AUS guidelines for all Avastin cases. Now that guideline doesn't tell us about ROP. Actually, it strictly mentions that it's not for ROP. So for ROP, I take a special consent. I have better counseling, consent. If you are concerned, take a video consent for that patient and explain to the family that, look, we are in a tight situation. If I don't treat, there's a problem. If I treat, there may be certain issues, okay? And have a frank discussion, and then the family, make them part of your team. Don't put them on the other side. Don't put them on the defensive. I don't want you to scare somebody. Like, I had a patient who was 90 years old in Bombay. She's a very active lady. She's blind in one eye. She has a CNVM in other eye. And people are telling her, don't take anti-VEGF because you can get stroke. So the whole family is worried if she'll get stroke. I called the family and said, look, at 90, she can die tomorrow. Okay, but I don't want her to be blind because I don't know, she may live another 5 years. So there is no high risk of stroke. The data says that there may be little risk of stroke, but that she has anyway with age.
Madam. Absolutely, madam. Thank you.
So
thank
I think the details and how you prepare for
that. It is an emotional outburst, actually.
No, it's not emotional. It's not emotional. It's practical. Please have the proper protocols.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Please have documented discussion.
Yeah.
Even if you don't have video recording, note down. Give a copy to the parent.
Yeah.
Take proper consent. Take all the precautions. And if a complication develops,
sure,
then be prepared to handle it and document that handling.
Okay.
Sure. Then you are safe.
Thank you very much.
How safe is Lucent is compared to...
Now we don't have much time. Now we'll just go through the video of safe intravitreal injection, which is an important thing. Just look at the video. Can we have the volume also?
Injections are becoming very common procedures and presently second only to cataract surgery as intraocular procedure. In the recent future, intravitreal injection may become even more common than cataract surgery. It is very important to master this technique because of the potential complications like lens damage, retinal perforation, bleeding and retinal detachment. This small video shows a technique of intravitreal injection. Please use the guidelines given in your manual for all references. Under topical anesthesia, the eye is cleaned with povidone iodine with special emphasis to the lids and lid margins. A speculum is applied. An anterior chamber paracentesis may decompress the eye and prevent pressure surges during the injection. We usually measure 3.5 to 4 millimeter from the limbus with a caliper to reach the entry site of the pars plana. This will avoid injury to the lens and the retina. The needle is slowly introduced and then directed towards the center of the globe. The drug is slowly injected, and when the needle is withdrawn, we may use a limb's forceps to pinch the entry wound to prevent the regurgitation of vitreous or the drug. Topical antibiotic is instilled, speculum is removed, and pad and patch is given. Pupillary dilatation is preferred for adequate visualization after the injection is given, especially if you are not performing a paracentesis. Supplemental subconjunctival anesthetic may be used with the topical anesthetic. The speculum is generally recommended to avoid the needle contact with lids and lashes. The injection is placed through the pars plana, usually in the infratemporal quadrant, 3.5 mm to 4 mm posterior to the limbus, as was already mentioned. The needle size usually used is 27 gauge or smaller, with a length of about 0.5 to 0.62 inches. Insert the needle at least 6 mm towards the center of the eye. Let us just revise the protocol once more. apply topical anesthetic, apply povidone iodine to the lid margins, lashes, conjunctival surface, and then insert the speculum. Apply additional drop of povidone iodine to the site of injection. Paracentesis. Measure 3.5 to 4 millimeters from the limbus using a calipers and mark it. Slowly insert the needle. Gently inject the therapeutic agent. Remove the needle. Topical antibiotics may be used post-injection. If IOP rises very high, it can induce a central retinal artery occlusion. Hence, it is a good practice to check vision and IOP 1 hour after the procedure. If not, then the patients may be reviewed after 1 day. Thus, a good technique of intravitreal injection is required not only for better results, but to prevent grave complications.
Thank you very much.
Lenses retinal damage, central retinal artery occlusion, and even endophthalmitis.
Thank you very much for your patient hearing. We are at the end of our time. I thank you once again. If there are any questions, we are available. Please come and talk to us. Thank you very much.